listen to God.
God can heal.
God can heal.
Oh, yeah.
He can heal.
Live with hope in your heart.
Adore Jesus.
My desire and our aim today is basically that you and me will grasp the meaning and the significance of the baptism in the Holy Spirit. And we are basically going to invite all of us, that's our desire and our aim today, to invite every single one of us to experience the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our objectives will be today to gain, number one, to gain knowledge and understanding about the baptism in the Holy Spirit. Secondly, to appreciate the significance of the baptism in the Holy Spirit and ministry of the believer. And thirdly, we choose to commit to the experience of the baptism in the Holy Spirit as a necessity for the spiritual journey. Now, this subject of the baptism of the Holy Spirit has had various notions and controversies with it. But I will tell you, for us, we believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and we will let you know why we have this conviction that every child of God needs to experience the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And we begin by asking the question, what is baptism in the Holy Spirit? What is baptism in the Holy Spirit? Number one, baptism is an act of immersion. Baptism is an act of immersion. The word baptism, in ancient Greek, the word simply is described as baptismos. Baptizo, which literally means dipping as in liquid. In this sense, then, baptism in the Holy Spirit will have the sense of dipping or immersing in the Holy Spirit. And when you read the Bible in the book of Joel, chapter 2, verse 28, it says, "And afterward I will pour out my spirit on all people." Acts 2:22 again talks about the Holy Spirit coming as a violent wind and filling the whole house where they were meeting and praying together. So in other words, the Holy Spirit comes and we, you and me, are immersed in Him. We are baptized in Him. In both verses, the impression is that of drenching. We are immersed. Secondly, the Holy Spirit baptism was predicted by Joel. So this issue of the baptism by the Holy Spirit was actually prophesied by Joel. This is in Joel chapter 2. Verses 28 to 29. And it says, "Afterward, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days." And we are living in those days. We are in the dispensation, in the life after the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. In John chapter 14, Jesus himself promised that after I'm gone, I'm going to send you a counselor. I will send you a comforter. I will send you the Spirit of God to be with you. Thirdly, the Holy Spirit baptism was confirmed by John the Baptist. John the Baptist confirms this in Matthew 3:11. He says, "I baptize you with water for repentance, but after me will come one who is more powerful than I, whose sandals I am not fit to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire." Again, another confirmation by this man, John the Baptist, who came to prepare the way for the Lord. You need to realize that John here was announcing that there was coming one with a different kind of baptism, the baptism by the Holy Spirit. Thus, it was different and distinct from the one John conducted, baptism with water. So, in the life of a believer, there are two kinds of baptism, baptism by water and baptism by the Holy Spirit. Jesus also mentions the same. Holy Spirit baptism was reaffirmed by Jesus. Prior to his ascension into heaven, Jesus directs his disciples to stay in Jerusalem. And he tells them, wait to be baptized by the Holy Spirit. And when you read the book of Acts chapter 1, from verses 4 to 5, it tells you how the Holy Spirit came upon the disciples as they were waiting on the Lord, waiting to receive that gift that the Lord had promised to them. Jesus mentions two significant things about the new baptism. He mentioned that it will first be fulfilled. It's a fulfillment of the promise of God. And secondly, it will be an additional experience to the baptism of John. So when I meet individuals who tend to differ with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, I tend to wonder, which Bible are they reading? Because Jesus clearly indicated and said that indeed the baptism of the Holy Spirit will be a fulfillment of a promise he made, as I got to refer to in John chapter 14. Then also he says this is an additional experience to the baptism of John. And fifthly, we come to see the Holy Spirit baptism was fulfilled at Pentecost. Again, after the ascension of Jesus, as the disciples were gathered in the upper room on that day of Pentecost, a special outpouring of the Holy Spirit came upon them. When you read the book of Acts chapter 2, from verses 1 all through to 4. But the part that I love in this portion of scripture, let me just read it. It says, when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. And the Bible says, all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit of God enabled them. It does not speak of a few. Praise the living God. It speaks of all. Turn to your neighbor and tell him or her all. Every single person. It is possible that the Lord is able to fill all of us in this place. It is possible. The Lord is able to grant us the power of the Spirit of God. The Lord is able to baptize us in Him if we all desire and wait upon Him. Praise the living God. This baptism by the Holy Spirit was promised by Jesus. It was the mark that the Holy Spirit had come upon them, and they were now initiated into the realm of the Holy Spirit. So what is the significance? What is the importance of the Holy Spirit baptism? The Holy Spirit baptism marks a significant turning point at that time. It marked a significant turning point in the life and ministry of the disciples. And there are several changes that I'd want us to look into. And number one, the word of the Lord says, the disciples became bold witnesses. The disciples became bold witnesses. The disciples acquired a noticeable sense of boldness in expressing their faith. When you read about this man called Peter, we see him preaching with such confidence and boldness. Now, this is the same Peter, if you try to compare before, was the same man at one point who would walk around with a sword in his belt. So Peter was that kind of guy. You know, he'll always, as much as he's preaching and he's there, he had something in his belt. If things got bad, he was willing to take off. He was willing to deny Christ, to deny faith and say, you know, I don't know who you're talking about. I don't know that person. But here comes Peter. In the book of Acts chapter 2, verse 14 to 37, that Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd. Fellow Jews and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say to you. And in Acts 2, verses 37 to 38, the Bible says that when the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, brothers, what shall we do? Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. On that occasion, 3,000 souls came to the Lord. This is Peter. It's the same man in the book of Acts chapter 4. The teachers of the law look and they asked, who are these unschooled ordinary men? They were able to stand among us, the high and the mighty in the society, and address them on the face, telling them of the salvation and the work of Jesus Christ in the life of man. That is what the Lord does. And I believe you could be here and you're looking at your life and you wonder, I never have the courage to share my faith. I never have the boldness to share my faith. The other day I was listening to Ben Carson and he was expounding on the book of Matthew chapter 28 verses 18 to 20. And you all know that verse. And many times when you go to mission conferences that, you know, they're speaking about missions and what have you, they're always, you know, mentioning and highlighting that scripture. And it talks about go ye into the whole world. Go ye into the whole world. And what he said is that many of us think that, you know, to fulfill this verse, I need to go to Somalia. I need to go to Egypt. I need to go to South Africa. I need to go to this and that country. No, I believe all of us live in the world. And I love how he brought it across, that all of us live in a world. And what Jesus was simply saying is, wherever you are positioned in the world, preach the gospel. Praise the living God. In your own family, in your own place, wherever the Lord places you, you see, where God places you, that is your world. Praise the living God. And it is the Holy Spirit who comes to give us boldness to proclaim the word of God. You may not be at their age, you may not be at their level, but one thing you know, that by the Spirit of God, he gives us the boldness to witness. Praise the living God. And secondly, the disciples cultivated a special spirit of devotion. After the baptism, we get to see a different church in the book of Acts chapter 2 verse 42. Scripture says they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. A completely different picture of the church that existed then. What happened? What was different this time? They had experienced the baptism of the Holy Spirit. If you desire to grow in your devotion to the Lord, if you desire to grow in your commitment with God, as our pastor led us through last Sunday, that the Holy Spirit comes to help us and he gives us power unto holiness, power unto service. It is the Spirit of God that is able to excel in these areas. The Holy Spirit comes and he creates a desire in us, a special desire for spiritual things. Romans 8:5 says, for those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit, they set their minds on the things of the Spirit. We are living in days, and let me tell you, there's a certain form of Christianity that is springing up in our day and time, whereby sin is no longer being considered as sin. Sin is now being considered as a weakness, and it's happening in the body of Christ. We're living in days and times when, as some of us attended the regional discipleship conference, and the speaker was bringing about the aspect of the worldview, that we are no longer concerned. We no longer adhere to the biblical worldview, but rather is the secular worldview that has the say. That you can meet a believer and they will ask you, this is how I feel God is telling me to do things. Have you experienced that? Or have you said that? I feel God wants me to go this direction. But let me mention to us today, may we be filled with the Holy Spirit. Praise the living God. That we will know where the line lies. We will know what is the perfect, the pleasing, the acceptable will of God concerning our lives in this day and age. When some people have chosen to borrow things from the world, the reality today is that the enemy is simply finding his way in the church and in the lives of many believers. Some things that scripture says in the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 19, it talks about do not quench the Spirit of God. Do not grieve the Spirit of God. When the Holy Spirit is in our lives and we fail to obey, when we fail to do what God desires of our lives, it's very simple. The Holy Spirit is a person, and you learned that on the third, isn't it? What does he do? He moves away and he allows you to run your own life. Friends, may we be filled with the Holy Spirit. For the Holy Spirit will help us to know what is expected of us. The Holy Spirit will help you and me live according to the Spirit. It is possible for you to say you're a child of God, but you're not living according to the Spirit. Do you know that? Very possible. But today the Lord is saying, may you be filled with me. Because when you are filled with me, you will set your mind not what on the flesh desires, but what Christ and what the Spirit of God desires. Galatians 6:8 puts it across so well. That when you sow in the sinful nature, from the sinful nature, you shall reap from it. But when you sow from the Spirit, you shall reap eternal life. Praise the living God. Today the Lord desires of you to have life. And for me, what excites me and what keeps me going as a child of God is that I don't need to rely on my own strength, on my own abilities. I just need to rely on the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. Praise the living God. Thirdly, the disciples witnessed miracles and wonders. Acts 2:43 says, everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. Compare this in Mark chapter 9, verse 17 to 18. A man in the crowd, and let me tell you, crowds can be bad news. One man comes and says, teacher, I brought you my son. He was going to report the disciples to Jesus. I brought you my son, who is possessed by a spirit that has robbed him of speech. I asked your disciples to drive out the spirit, but they could. The Bible says they could not. I could just imagine the faces of the disciples, you know, and I'm sure they must have prayed, done everything, you know. Some of us, when you are starting off, we would try to, copy and emulate what other men of God do, when, especially in those situations, you know. And at times you pray for 5 hours, nothing. Man, you go back discouraged, questioning your call and what have you. But the Bible says, after these men were baptized with the Holy Spirit, miracles and wonders followed them. Friends, miracles and wonders can still exist today. Can still be seen today. They can still be experienced today when we choose to be filled with the Spirit. The Holy Spirit empowers for extraordinary spiritual gifts. Fourthly, the disciples developed a unique sense of unity. When you read Acts chapter 2, amazing unity in the body of Christ. And could it be, as compared in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 3 to 4, we see Paul evaluating the conduct of the Corinthians. Corinthian church was a very interesting church. I was in a Bible school at some point, and I recall every time this one specific person would stand up to read from the book of Corinthians would know things are not right. Some of you will get that tomorrow, but it's okay. And Paul comes and he evaluates this church. It was a very interesting church. But one thing for sure, the secret lies in being filled with the Spirit of God. Praise the living God. We are human in our relationships, but until we have the Spirit of God in our lives, some of these things will keep popping every now and again. You'll find believers holding each other's shirts, isn't it? You find believers doing stuff, but until we allow the Holy Spirit to come and take full charge and control of our lives, then, only then, shall we enjoy a victorious Christian life. A question that many of you have been asking is the Spirit baptism different from being Spirit-filled? Though sometimes the two words can be used interchangeably, they're a bit different. We believe that Spirit baptism, the Holy Spirit baptism, occurs actually once. And this is why the term baptism generally infers an act of initiation. Okay? It's a one-time thing. And when you read the book of Genesis 17, verse 9, to one, it talks about, then God said to Abraham, as for you, you must keep my covenant. You are to undergo circumcision, and it will be the sign of the covenant between me and you. In other words, circumcision was a one-time thing. A man cannot be circumcised twice. And similarly, even with water baptism, you cannot be baptized twice. Acts 2, verses 38 to 41. The Bible says that those who accepted the message of Peter were baptized. And likewise, the baptism in the Holy Spirit is inferred to occur only once. And in Matthew 3:11, we see this man called John the Baptist saying, he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. To be Spirit-filled is continuous or repeated. And this is a prayer we need to be making every now and again. This is a prayer you ought to be praying every single morning. Lord, may you fill my life afresh When you read of Acts chapter 4 verse 8, Peter filled with the Holy Spirit said to them, rulers and elders of the people, filled with the Holy Spirit. Ephesians 5:18 says, do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit. May the Lord fill our hearts and souls. And another question we ask, is it necessary to be baptized in the Holy Spirit? Is it really, really necessary? And I love how the author of this manual puts it across. This is similar to asking whether circumcision was necessary for every believer under the Abrahamic covenant. Again, it's like asking whether water baptism was necessary after salvation through Jesus Christ. So what you're simply saying here is that we need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit if we are to operate effectively in the realm of the Holy Spirit. We need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. We see Paul encouraged the Ephesians to receive the Holy Spirit baptism in Acts chapter 19, verse 1 to 2. And he comes and he tells his believers at Ephesus, you need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And the thing is that, friends, since we are here and we all want to live lives that are devoted and given to the Lord is asking of us today, may we be filled with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, when you read the book of Acts chapter 19, was definitely already dwelling in them. But you need to realize that we cannot have a believer without the Holy Spirit. And now Paul was simply asking them about a different kind of encounter with the Holy Spirit. And this is what we call the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We believe that the point somebody says they have accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior in their lives, the Holy Spirit comes and fills them. Something else you need to realize is that the Holy Spirit baptism authenticated Gentile believers. The Holy Spirit baptism authenticated Gentile believers. One of the largest debates that existed then was whether salvation that came through the Lord Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit was available for the Gentile believers. But when you read the book of Acts chapter 10, verses 44 to 47, it says that while Peter was still speaking this word, the Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had even been poured out to the Gentiles. And that is why I'm here to mention to us that the Holy Spirit is given to us without discrimination. Amen. The Holy Spirit comes and fills each and every one of us. It was a clear evidence that these Gentile believers had not only been accepted by God, but also initiated into the realm and the place of the Spirit of God. So we ask the question. So then, what evidence do we have about the Holy Spirit baptism? When you read the book of Acts, where we find these three major evidences, they are clearly indicated. And the first one is, we get to realize that at the upper room, they all spoke in other tongues. This is in Acts chapter 2, verse 1 to 4. Then secondly also, in Cornelius' house, they spoke in tongues and praised God, as highlighted in the book of Acts chapter 10, verses 44 to 46. Then thirdly, we get to see, as I mentioned earlier on, the church at Ephesus. In Ephesus, they spoke in tongues and prophesied, Acts 19, verses 3 to 6. The one common feature in all these cases is speaking in tongues. It will follow, therefore, that speaking in tongues is a key public evidence of the baptism in the Holy Spirit. Many people have come up and said, well, it is only in these two major areas that we find, especially in the book of Acts and throughout the New Testament, we get to see the experience of the Holy Spirit baptism through the evidence of speaking in tongues. And some people argue out that there were many conversions during that very particular time. But how comes we as Pentecostal term we actually come to the point of saying that for us to know that you have the Holy Spirit baptism, we need to see the evidence of speaking in tongues. And you know, I struggle a bit with that. And for sure, there are only two incidences. And I struggled a bit with that. But I sat back and the Lord began ministering to me. And I said, you know what, friends? When I read the Bible, I want and I desire to go for the best. Praise the living God. I want to follow in the footsteps of David. Amen. I want to follow in the footsteps of Daniel. I want to follow in the footsteps of Peter. I want to follow in the footsteps of these great men and women of God who made a difference. Praise the Lord. People who were right here, who obeyed Jesus, and they waited with him at Jerusalem, waiting to receive the promise of the Holy Spirit. I want to be identified with that group. People who will come to Jesus and they say, I desire the best. Give me everything you have to offer. I thank God for salvation. Amen. I thank God for all these other things. But Lord, what level can I move with you? Up to what height can I go with you to the glory and the honor of your name? And that's what I'm here to say. Whether there are two or three or four or five incidences that speak about the Holy Spirit baptism, one thing I will assure you, that the Holy Spirit baptism is available for every single believer. Praise the living God. And it brings me to this point. So how do we receive the Holy Spirit baptism? Child of God, if it means me speaking with boldness, if it means us living a life that is fully devoted and given to God, if it means us working wonders and miracles in our generations, if it means us being at that level of operating in the spirit realm, at the place where God has intended it to be, we need to receive the Holy Spirit in our lives. And I'm here to mention to us that there is no formula for receiving the Holy Spirit baptism. Some of you, your hearts may be dropping right now. And I'm here to mention to us that just like salvation, there's no drama involved in the Holy Spirit baptism. The Holy Spirit is received by faith. The Holy Spirit is received by faith. Although we cannot see the Holy Spirit with our own eyes, although at times we cannot be able to hold the Holy Spirit with our physical hands or posture, the thing is, you and me can be able to sense his work in our lives. You and me can be able to see what he does in our lives. You and me can be able to experience his power, his salvation, his grace, his wisdom, his guidance, his leading, his comfort, his strength when we are in need of it. Today, friends, you and me can receive the Holy Spirit, but it has to take you to have faith and to believe in him. Praise the living God. John, the Spirit, friends, is for all who desire. The Spirit of God is for all who desire. The Holy Spirit is available for all believers. But the critical thing here is that we ought to have an expectant heart and a desire to be baptized. You need to realize that the Holy Spirit is given to us as a gift. The Bible says in John 7, 37 to 39, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. So the Holy Spirit is available. The Father is ready and willing to give all who ask. He is ready and willing to give all who ask.